computer architecture. Let's take a look at the physical memory of a computer. For that purpose, I have made here this figure, and you can see here a so-called 4x4 memory cell. We could call this one chip, one IC, and it consists of four words, each containing 4 bits. And let me try to explain to you how this works. I presume that you know all the components. So we have here, for instance, a D-type data type flip-flop, 4 of them, 4 rows of them. Here we have our AND ports. The output is 1 if both inputs are 1. If not, the output is 0. Here we have more AND ports. These components are OR ports. It's a little bit strange because they have 4 inputs. But you know by now that this is just symbolic to write. Of course, they are implemented in binary gates. And the final component, which you of course already know, is the tri-state outputs. This is a way to disconnect the output to make it in high impedance, meaning that it doesn't matter what is on this side of the tri-state. On the other side, it is basically simply disconnected. And then in this way, we can have the memory organized. Let's see how this works. First, we have here on top, we have the data bus. So this connects, for instance, on the right to the CPU, or it connects to other things. This is a bus in that everybody can listen, but only one can talk. So only one can put the tri-state in such a state that it's connected to the bus for writing. All the others, they have to listen. The data that are listened to are copied or are connected here to the flip-flops, a set of flip-flops. So this line, let's call this the most significant bit, goes to this flip-flop, and this one, and this one, and this one, all 4 of them. This, the second most significant bit, connects to these 4 flip-flops, and so on. And this line here, this column, I should say, is the least significant bit of a word. Now, which word then? Imagine we want to do a read. We want to write into these flip-flops. What does it have to do that this flip-flop will take the value that is copied at the entrance? We of course know that it has to have a clock cycle to the flip-flop. Then the output Q will be copied from the input. If the clock is not asserted, then nothing will happen and the output will stay constant, as you know. So how does this happen? When does it get a clock? We can see this from this AND port. This comes from one line, it's an AND. One of the line is the what we call the decoder. The decoder is connected to the address line. And as you can see, they are 4 AND ports and they all have 4 different combinations. This one has the 2 address lines negated. This one has the most significant bit negated. This one has the least significant bit negated. And this one has none of them negated. So imagine that the address line here is 1, 1. Then this one will be 1100, 2 inverted, so it will be 0 at the output. This one will be 0, 1. And it will be 0 at the output. This one will be 1, 0 and will have 0 at the output. And this one will have 1, 1 and have 1 at the output. So this AND gate has 1, 1 at the input. And the other one, it then comes from this, what we call the control line. The control line consists of, it has to do 2 things. First, it has to have chip select, meaning that the entire chip has to be activated. If not, nothing will happen inside the chip, completely nothing. And on the other side, it also has to have a read, that meaning a not read. A not read means a write. So if you want to write and we have the chip selected, then this line is also 1, and we have here 1, 1, and this output is 1. Here we had 1, 0, and this output is 0. Here we had 1, 0, and this output is 0. Here we have 1, 0, and this output is 0. So this line does not get any clock cycle. This line does not get any clock cycle. This line doesn't get any clock pulse, I should say. And this line of flip-flops, or this word, we can call it, most significant word, with address 1, 1 here, this one will output 1 and will put a pulse on the clock, and it will copy from the data bus into the flip-flop, and the output will be equal to what is on the data bus. So this is nice. Now we have put a value into this, into this, into this, and into this, because they all get from here, they get the clock pulse. All the others, they don't get clock pulses. All these here, they don't get clock pulses. And in the same time, if we want to have a read cycle, meaning also that we want output enable, then the opposite happens. Imagine we do a read cycle. First of all, we have to have a chip select, of course, otherwise nothing happens. And we do a read. A read meaning this is 1 here on this AND gate, it's 1. This one will be, read will be 1, but will is inverted, so it's 0. This one is 1, but 0 and 1 is 0. So nothing happens. None of these will get a clock pulse, so none of them will copy from the data bus into the flip-flops. None of them are actually loading. But we can also see if we have output enable, if we have read, and we have chip select, then we have this tri-state is triggered. So now this entire chip is going to be a talker. So whatever is appearing here will be copied and placed on the data bus. Now, once again, what will be copied to the data bus? Let's take a look. Here we have the address. Let's take again, let's put here 1, 1, address 1, 1. This one is 0, this one is 0, this one is 0, and this one is 1. But this one, of course, will do nothing. The clock pulse will do nothing. But we have here an AND gate, and it will AND this output into this one, which is 1, and will make here whatever is Q is now also here is Q, because 1 and Q, whatever is Q is here. 1 and 0 will be 0, and 1 and 1 will be 1. So on this AND gate, the output will be Q. Da-da-da, it goes here to the OR gate, and it will sum all of the other bits as well. So let's take a look at this AND gate. This AND gate had a 0 from this line here. So 0 from this line, whatever is Q, there will be 0 here. Same for this one. This one had 0 from this AND gate, and 0 plus whatever is 0. This one has 0 from this AND gate, 0 and whatever is 0, so this is also 0. So we have here 0, 0, 0, and Q. And we sum them, meaning we OR them, so Q from this flip-flop OR 0, OR 0, OR 0 is Q. So we have here Q entering into this tri-state. The Q from this flip-flop will appear here and will be put here on the data bus, because the tri-state is active. Because we have chip select, yes, we're talking to this chip, this is one entire chip. We have a read, we want to read from the flip-flops. And we do output enable, meaning yes, we want to be a talker. The chip wants to talk, is going to talk and put whatever appears here on the data bus. Now, of course, in reality, this is slightly different, because the random access memory is this is quite complex. This is made out of flip-flops, and each flip-flop, as you know, contains a couple of logic gates, and every logic gate has a couple of transistors. So you're easily talking about 30, 40 transistors for one of these elements. And of course, we want to have much higher density of information. So in reality, what we call, this is called the static RAM, because we can, as long as we do nothing, we don't have to do anything, and the contents of these flip-flops, they will remain. But in reality, the memory that you have in your computer is static, is dynamic. And I have here put here a picture for you how, what is the difference. I found this on Wikipedia, and it's not made by me. And I see here that what is dynamic RAM is not flip-flops. So this is also a 4x4 memory cell. This is not done by flip-flops, but by much simpler elements, namely one capacitor that can store charge and one transistor. So this capacitor, if it is full, then it's being, we call it a 1, and if it is empty, then we call it a 0. And this transistor now can access, can open this transistor, can open so that whatever is here, the line is here, can either write in this capacitor, namely storing charge in there, or can see how much charge is there. So that if we do, for instance, do a read, we open this transistor more or less in the same way as we done here with the decoder or multiplexer, what you want to call it, and things like this will also appear there, and the tri-state for sure will also be there, as you can see here at the bottom, tri-state. But the thing is that if we address this element, we can, for instance, read it, just checking how much of the charge is in there, and we have here some kind of system reading. It will then put how much charge is in there and through a latch and put it there onto the data bus. And if we want to write in there, then we put here one. It's a little bit strange how this works, but if you want to write in it, we put this, place this selector in here, and we can store actually charge in there also, of course, always by opening this transistor. If not, nothing happens, the charge will remain there. That is to say, the charge will remain there, but not forever. These charges, these capacitors are quite leaky, so very slowly the charge is leaking out, and slowly we have to think about in terms of milliseconds, which for a computer is actually very slow, but for us is quite fast, of course. So what does this entire system has to do? Here must be some control logic, which I don't see here, but what it is doing, it is every millisecond it is reading how much charge is in these capacitors, and then again writing that amount of charge in these capacitors. So it is reading a 1 or a 0, and then writing a 1 or a 0 in there. And in this way we call it a dynamic RAM. The problem with this is it needs a little bit extra control logic, because it has to read-write 1,000 times per second. But on the other hand, as you can see, this one bit cost much less space, much less transistors than a full flip-flop as you have here. This is about 30-40 transistors, and this is, let's call it 2 transistors, because a capacitor normally is made in more or less the same way as these transistors are made. It is just connecting the source to the drain, and you have a capacitor instead of a transistor. But this you can see it, we have here a picture of static RAM, random access memory. We can access it, we can write in it, we can rewrite into these elements by placing things on the data bus and addressing it so that we put it in the correct flip-flops, and we can also read them, and then we are copying them to the data bus. And now you have to imagine, with dynamic RAM, each of these elements is actually replacing one of these flip-flops, and there is a little bit more control logic, because it has to be refreshing all the time, and that's also why it's called dynamic RAM. It's a little bit slower also, it takes a little bit more overhead, but all in all the density of bits is much higher than on static RAM. So static RAM is normally used inside the CPU, it's fast and nice, but a little bit complex, and this one is a little bit slower, but takes much less space. So that is then the advantage of that. See you in the next lecture.